Well, I know that the similar kind of from the approval is developed, and the support people are
Only What ship do you want?
What do you want?
Good nights, days, and afternoons.
Okay, boys. Bring call everything to order.
No.
First of all, I've got apologies for Len Jones. Len has gone to Holland this morning. Meetings have been arranged with the support groups. We couldn't cancel it, so Len has gone with Mary Coombs, and they'll be there for a couple of days. Bear in mind that even though the strike has come to an end, we still need the finance to continue to relieve the continuing hardship that we're going to experience. Apologies for Emlyn Thomas. Emlyn's got other activities this morning, but I think we'll try and get the general meeting this morning. Well, two items on the agenda. First, to receive the report of the delegate conference that took place in London yesterday. And our recommendation to the general meeting at 12 o'clock this morning. And then to discuss the details of the orderly return to work, which will involve a discussion around us marching back to work from the strike centre to the pit, led by the Calvary Band. But I'll go into further detail when we discuss that. I'd like to come back to the delegate conference. By now, I think most of you are aware that the delegates supported a resolution by 1991 for a return to work without any negotiated settlement on Tuesday morning. As you can see, it was a very close decision. No doubt that areas like Yorkshire and Kent were opposed to a return, and I think what they were saying quite clearly that they will not return to work until the coal board agree the amnesty for all of the 700 men. And I think if we reflect back, because all of you were in the South Wales Conference, that we were saying almost the same thing, that as far as we were concerned, the uppermost thing in our minds, the priority in our minds was that when we returned to work, that the men sacked in this dispute on the front line of the picket lines, in confrontation with the police, giving their lives to this dispute, that we would put them in priority as far as us returning to work. I think it's a question of how we read the position. We were saying that if the union was allowed to be overtaken by the return to work, if the union were to be smashed, I think the South Wales miners were saying quite clearly that that would kill any kind of negotiating strength that we would have with the coal board. But whether we like it or not, we've held this strike up in Wales with over 98% of our men supporting us for quite a long time. We've supported it in a way that the other coal fields have seen that the South Wales coalfield are the leading sort of area within this strike. And I think that the decision of our conference that was recommended to the National Conference yesterday is still the correct decision. I know it's a bitter pill to swallow that we're going back to work without a negotiated settlement. We're going back to work with coal board's pit closure programme still on the agenda. But nevertheless, we are telling the coal board quite clearly, especially in Wales, that 92% of the membership are still behind us. If you think that we are beaten, we think that we are lying down for you to crawl over us in any kind of attempt, either on the closure programme or in the running of the industry, then I think the coal board ought to think twice about that. I think that's vitally important that we project that at the general meeting this morning, that the unity of the union is intact, that the NOM is not destroyed, it's not in pieces, that we are looking forward, if we like, to the battles that we're going to be confronted with, but we're looking forward to it. We're able to tell our membership and lead our membership that we're going forward together. Well, I know there are going to be a lot of criticisms. Already this morning, we've heard that certain pits in the South Wales Coalfield have said that the South Wales NUM, the executive, have sold us out. Okay, I think people after 12 months of strike are entitled to criticism. But I think we've got to think it through, that if we allowed this week, and as was projected by the President last week, if we allow the men returning to work to overtake us, then certainly that would give us no future. And I think these pits that are holding out ought to consider that. Within the return to work, you've also got to consider that possibly that there may be attempts by certain parts of the other coal fields, or the men even sat to be on the gates when we go back to work tomorrow morning. But I think our position is quite clear, that as far as we are concerned, as involved trade unionists, as very conscious trade unionists, that we would never, ever cross a picket line. And if we are confronted tomorrow morning with that, then quite clearly we will discuss with the picket line and hopefully get a resolve in line with the decisions of the South Wales Conference and the NEC. A failure to do that, then the principle of going through a picket line, even after 12 of the strike, will be our main concern. And we will not cross that picket line. We will have to withdraw from the pit. We'll have to meet our own men. We'll have to decide where we go on this. So I think, you know, we've got to now this morning project to the membership position that we're in terms of pit closures, because Mardi could be one. Let's not bury our heads in the sand, that the closure programme, as weeks projected, nationally is 13%, but in Wales we could see 6 pits immediately. I'm not confident it could be just at 6 pits. It could be 8, 10 or 12. But I think what we could project this morning, that we're not beaten, that we will continue to stand and fight alongside the determination that we've shown in the 12 months. I think that we ought to, as well this morning, even though we did it to some measure on Saturday, pay tremendous recognition to the whole of the community, and especially to the women's support groups. And I'm convinced, and I'm sure I'm speaking for everyone, without the support that we had from the women's support groups, I think it would be very difficult for us to continue with the hardships that we've experienced and the struggles that we've experienced without them alongside us. So I think that we ought to, yes, let's have a clear analysis of the strike. Let's have clear criticisms. Then let's show positiveness. But the coal board and the government are looking for us to go back tomorrow morning, head between our knees, defeated. Let's put the message out loud and clear to Thatcher and the coal board. We're going back, not humiliated, but together, heads held high, future battles with a new kind of politics around us, with the community, and all that strength is with us. Okay?
Yeah. Well, arrangements for tomorrow morning will be that no works bus will reach the pit in the morning. Everyone will disembark at Mardi Workman's Hall. The band will lead a procession, and we'll all march behind the banner. The women's support groups will have their banner, and it will be an orderly return to work through the gates united. The one thing we've got to do in the general meeting later on is to lift the men up. We don't want a dejected workforce returning tomorrow. We want a workforce with the objectives of fighting pit closures, because that's what the fight has been all about. I know it's been shaded and coloured, clouded by all different things, the attacks on Skaga, there was a political strike and everything else. We're going back to work tomorrow, and we are still opposing pit closures. We are not a beaten workforce, and that's the message we've got to put to the workforce this morning.
Mr. Chairman, I think the first thing we've got to do is hit it on the head about this permanent attack on Skaga. Let's get it straight. It's not Stalin who's took us back. It's the bloody men who's forced us back.
Exactly.
Well, if we put it in this perspective, it's the government right? Norwood, right? And men are a symptom to that.
Yeah.
It's a determination of Thatcher to use the courts and the police and the DHSS, the arm of the state. It's a bloody big weapon they've used, but courageously. Mine has a family that's still out for 12 months. She's not defeated us. And if men were driven back, they were driven back by that weapon that the government had.
Chairman, far from defeating us, I think she's starting to defeat herself. Over this 12 months, we have, in my opinion, we've done a great service to the labour and trade union movement. We've woken the sleeping giant. You've shown them that you can fight against closures. You can fight against government policies that we don't agree with. And I believe that this last 12 months, the West Fight Day, has woken up the labour and trade union movement. I made them aware of where they were and how lax and how bad the position with them was. And I believe that this struggle will wake them up. And I believe that we have started Thatcher's downfall. Because people all over this country will have probably more sympathy for the miners now than we were on what they did. And I'm going to go straight. Because they can see what this government is doing. They want to drive this into the dust. And they're not going to bring this into the dust. We've seen the reality of the situation. And we've not allowed them to break our union up. We're going back. And we're going to start fighting from within. We're going to change our tactics. That's all we're going to do. Change our tactics. Not going to lay down. We're going to fight on. And they've got to know that now.
You know, I only hope people will wake up now and realize that what this woman, the lens this woman have gone to control the minor strikes, as this chairman just said. She turned the old state machines. The law, the police are on it, and the cops are on it. I hope the very little bit class realize just what will happen if ever they go to want to dispute anything.
Yeah. Three short points I'd like to make, Mr. Chairman, that's in relation to the NEC vote yesterday. I reckon it was a terrible vote, you know, and a dishonest vote because of the fact you have the Midlands area declaring we should stand fast between 80 and 90% of their members not ever taking any active part in the strike. And it's absolutely disgusting that they should have cast the vote in the way that they did, because it's just completely dishonest. Again, you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, in your opening remarks, the question of certain lodges in the Southwest coalfield having reservations on condemnation and criticism. I can understand it, as you said, I can understand it, right? But they have to, if you have criticism, it's got to be constructive criticism. Not criticism for the sake of criticising individuals or lodges or executives. It's a question you've got to put an alternative. If you're criticising an action that's been taken, you've got to put an alternative. And what was the alternative we were faced with in South Wales? It was that the men would drift back as they were, and they would have dragged the leadership back by their bootstraps. And that's not the way for an organisation to work, especially a responsible organisation like the National Union Mine Workers, and especially the South Wales area. Coming back to Mardi itself, there was a time, and Arthur Horner said in his book, The Incorrigible Rebel, that the time would come when it would be more important to save the organisation, meaning the union, than it would be for wages, because at that particular time the campaign was continually for wages. And he said it would be more important, and it was the most fundamental statement, to safeguard the organisation than it would be for wages. Another thing to come back to Mardi in history, Mardi, and it relates to this time, because when he came back from the Trade Union Congress, after the defeat of the miners in 1926, there was thousands of people waiting for that train to move into Mardi station, right? And he, as he said in his book, it filled him up. He said, burst into tears because he knew that if the feeling and the rest of the cold feeling and the rest of the trade union movement had been as strong as it was in Mali, we would have won the 1926 strike. And I'm saying here and now, if the feeling in the rest of the coalfield, both South Wales and Britain, is as strong as the feeling in Mali, we would have won the 1948-1984 strike as well. So Mali has got everything to be proud of. They got proud of the fact that not one individual crossed that picket line. And they've upheld the tradition, the best tradition that Mali has ever created. And personally speaking, I'm proud of this Lords Committee, I'm proud of the leadership, and most of all, I'm proud of the members and the women who supported them. We've got nothing to be ashamed of in Mali, and Mali can, men can go back with their heads held high.
One good thing has come out of it also, but the cost of the strike has been tremendous. I doubt very, very much if she is able to take on another organisation very short, you know, in a short time. She's going to wait now and bide her time, but she will do it. She'll attack the trade union movement as she's done all, you know, since she's been in office. But it's going to take her a long time to be able to sort of put up the sort of attacks on another trade union as she's done on us, because the amount of money that is, you know, taking her to break or try and break us. But as we said, we came up Aidan, they've not broken us, they've not broken the spirit. I'll always be there. No police, no amount of money can break these men and women's spirits. They'll always be there.
There is a fact, see, Mr. Chairman, that, like Alan just stated there, that the criticism of Arthur Scargill. But as we all know, Arthur Scargill has been criticised for the last 12 months. And why has he been criticised? Because he's been carrying out the policy of this trade union movement. And what a wonderful president to serve under. Yeah. And the finest president we've ever had. But there's one other thing, Mr. Chairman, too. I've always realised that the game isn't over till the final whistle is blown. And we'll go back elected, and we'll rise again to a trade union movement, because we are the finest trade union movement within the whole of the world. We are respected for it. And one day we'll come again, and we will see victory. We haven't lost our lads. We've gone back united, and that's the most important thing of it all. Gone back united, and we'll rise again, boys.
About the after the result of conference yesterday, and we did more sure scenes outside. Now these men have been sacked. It's our duty as trade unionists and the leadership to look after these men and give them every support we can. We have put on the area basis now the sets can be left to individual areas upon reinstatement of the zone. And we are obligated 100% of these men because if we can seem to be seen going down, leaving these men by the wayside, I should not think what's going to happen then. Because we're going to get ripped from the current opposed if we can these men go up. By their own workforce, I've got mixed thoughts about the other two parties that are trying to move on. But we obligated these men, Mr. Chairman, 100%. We've got to look after these jobs.
Let me spell out the Welsh coffee position. I mean, as you know, 40-odd men have been sacked. Return to work tomorrow. Emily Williams and George Rees will meet Weeks tomorrow, right? And they'll be able to meet Weeks with the 92% of their membership behind them. Now, if there's a failure, we'll have a report back on Saturday's conference. And what was spelled out quite clearly in the conference last Friday, that there will be no normal reconciliation in the South Wales coalfield until those men are reinstated. We must honour that. And I don't want to, at this stage, spell out what reconciliation or Norman reconciliation means. We know working in the coal industry, we know what cooperation means, right? Cooperation means a safe, efficient coal producing industry. Reconciliation abnormal means that the inefficiency of the industry will be clearly exposed. I think that we've got a lot in our favour. I think Jeff, what he was saying is right, and we're all sounding at you today, every one of us, that in our minds, going back to work, it's not just to get industry back, it's to get those men that have sacrificed alongside us through the gates as quickly as we possibly can. Now, somebody mentioned, I think Tubby,
but the fight isn't finished, and it's not. But I tell you what, now that we are going back to work, I think that...
The strike is now formally over here in Mardy, the political powerhouse and emotional heart of the South Wales coalfield. This is an emotional moment for the men of Mardy, one of only four pits in Great Britain to stay solid throughout the strike. But the message from the community of Mardy today is that the strike may be over, but the fight against pit closures will continue, no longer at the pit gates, but from now on at the pit heads.